morning. Would you turn to page, we turn to 1 Peter chapter 1, verses 3 to 28. It's on page 1075 in the Red Pew Bible. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. By his great mercy, he has given us a new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead and into an inheritance that is imperishable, undefiled, and unfading, kept in heaven for you, who are being protected by the power of God through faith for a salvation ready to be revealed in the last time. In this you rejoice, even if now, for a little while, you have had to suffer various trials, so that the genuineness of your faith, being more precious than gold, that, though perishable, is tested by fire, may be found to result in praise and glory and honor when Jesus Christ is revealed. Although you have not seen him, you love him. And even though you do not see him now, you believe in him and rejoice with an indescribable and glorious joy. For you are receiving the outcome of your faith, the salvation of your souls. Concerning this salvation, the prophets who prophesied of the grace that was to be yours made careful search and inquiry, inquiring about the person or time that the Spirit of Christ within them indicated when it testified in advance to the sufferings destined for Christ and the subsequent glory. It was revealed to them that they were serving not themselves, but you, in regard to the things that have now been announced to you through those who brought you good news by the Holy Spirit sent from heaven, things into which angels long to look. Therefore, prepare your minds for action. Discipline yourselves. Set all your hope on the grace that Jesus Christ will bring you when he is revealed. Like obedient children, do not be conformed to the desires that you formerly had in ignorance. Instead, as he who called you is holy, be holy yourselves in all your conduct. For it is written, you shall be holy, for I am holy. If you invoke as Father the one who judges all people impartially, according to your deeds, live in reverent fear during the time of your exile. You know that you are ransomed from the futile ways inherited from your ancestors, not with perishable things like silver or gold, but with the precious blood of Christ, like that of a lamb without defect or blemish. He was destined before the foundation of the world, but was revealed at the end of the ages for your sake. Through him you have come to trust in God, who raised him from the dead and gave him glory, so that your faith and hope are set on God. Let's pray. Living God, we thank you that you inspired your servant Peter to write this letter. We pray that you would be with us as we learn about what it means to follow you. Amen. So Peter wrote this letter to encourage Christians living in what is modern-day Turkey to endure in their faith despite the persecution that many of them were facing. This passage is a richly textured portion of Scripture, so we don't have the time to reflect on everything in verses 3 to 21. But for this morning, we'll look at three points. First, our rebirth through Christ by our merciful God. Second, how we are to respond in the midst of trials. Third, since our gracious God has given us a new birth through Christ and an everlasting inheritance, we are called to live lives of holiness. So what does it mean to be born again through Christ? Well, how does our passage begin? It begins with worship. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. Even though Peter is writing to Christian communities that are being oppressed, Peter begins with a posture of praise, and he commends his audience, those who have not seen Jesus with their own eyes, but who believe in him nonetheless, to rejoice. Biblical scholar Karen Jobes helpfully sets up our passage. She writes, doxology, that is praise, provides the context Christian's new life in Christ, because both their experiences of suffering, grief, and trials, and their present and ultimate salvation is the goal not only of their faith, but also of the plan of God as revealed to the prophets. But why do we praise God? The answer is a journey in and of itself. Let's examine verses 3 to 5 more closely. It is by God's great mercy that we have been given a new birth. Mercy is unmerited favor. We've done nothing to earn it. It is an act of gratuitous grace done by God, which allows us to be born again. Jesus told the Pharisee Nicodemus in John 3 that he had to be born again, and so do we. It's not about changing just one small segment of our lives, but a holistic transformation involving our mind, heart, and body as God justifies us and then sanctifies us through the Holy Spirit. Now, what are we born into? We are born into a living hope. This living hope is based upon a person. It is based upon the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead by God the Father Almighty. It is not a dead hope, for Jesus was resurrected to life. And so this living hope is already moving and working in the present, though we will not fully experience it until Christ returns in glory. Our salvation is already accomplished. Only the timing is yet to be revealed. How many people do you know who live in despair, without hope? What would it look like if they were born into the living hope of Jesus Christ? As part of our new birth into a living hope, we have gained an inheritance that is imperishable, undefiled, and unfading. So in one sense, we don't have it yet. It is kept in heaven for us. But we can be rest assured that it is waiting for us, and it's kept safe, where neither moth nor rust destroys, and where thieves do not break in and steal. It will not decay, it will not be spoiled, it will not end or lose its luster. That is what life in the kingdom of God is like. The promise of inheritance is all the more important for Peter's original audience because, just as today, in many parts of the world, entering into a relationship with Jesus was often dangerous. Becoming a Christian might have caused a deep rupture in your relationship with your friends, your family, and community. It may have caused you to lose your inheritance. How tempting would it have been to renounce your faith once you face pressure and persecution because of your beliefs? But how reassuring to know you have a future inheritance kept secure in heaven for you by God the Father. One New Testament scholar summarizes the situation that Peter's original audience finds themselves in. She writes, "Paradoxically, it is their faith in Christ that has put them in jeopardy with respect to their society, but it is that very faith in Christ that identifies them as legitimate heirs whom God powerfully protects. We are being protected through faith by God." The local theologian Roger Strongstad explains that faith is the human response necessary to appropriate God's provision. This faith needs to endure for a salvation ready to be revealed in the last time. Thus, both God's power and the Christian's faith are directed toward this final consummation of God's saving power. Continued faith is a condition for receiving the inheritance, the living hope, our salvation. And we read that our inheritance has been obtained for us through the precious blood of Christ. Christ died for our sins upon the cross of Calvary, and he died willingly for us, for that's how much he loved us. God could foresee even before he created human beings that we would fall, and that we would be marred by sin, and that we would be separated from him. But Jesus was destined before the foundation of the world to atone for our sin and bring us back to God. The God whom we believe in and worship raised Jesus from the dead and glorified him. And just as he raised Jesus from the dead, so too will he raise us to new life, to our inheritance, our salvation at the appointed time. Now we move on to our second point. As Christians, we will have to endure various trials. And how can it be otherwise in a fallen world? If anything, we should expect to experience more trials than non-Christians, for the devil is working all the harder to rend and ruin our relationship with Jesus. He does not need to worry as much about non-Christians who do not know Jesus. Peter tells us that, like a roaring lion, your adversary, the devil, prowls around looking for someone to devour. The devil is a predator, and he is driven to pick off as many members of the shepherd's flock as he can. Now, Peter was writing to Christians in Asia Minor who were suffering various trials, including their faith being slandered and maligned, their social status, family relationships, and possibly even their livelihood were threatened. Only a few decades after 1 Peter was written, many Christians in Asia Minor would be sent to their deaths. Today, Christianity is one of the most persecuted religions in the world. According to one report, 90,000 believers lost their lives because of their faith last year. I think particularly of the Christians who are being persecuted in the Middle East and other parts of the world because of their allegiance to our Lord Jesus Christ. And we must always keep them in our prayers. Now here in Vancouver in 2017, our situation is not quite as dire, and we can thank God for that. We are not being imprisoned or sent to our deaths, but it's not hard to see Jesus and our faith slandered. Like the first Christians living in the Roman Empire, our culture is inclusive and pluralistic and tolerant and seeks to affirm and include all kinds of different religions, beliefs, values, and morals. And this is not necessarily a bad thing, but this attitude of inclusion makes the exclusive claims of Christianity hard to accept among our friends, our neighbors, and our co-workers. Jesus declared that he is the way and the truth and the life, and that no one comes to the Father except through him. Peter's original hearers may have told their neighbors, the true God is not Mars, it's not Venus or Jupiter, it's Jesus Christ. Today, who or what are the false gods that we confront in our culture? Just as Peter's audience was, we may feel deflated and doubtful about our faith because we live in a culture that dismisses or rejects Jesus. Many things that the Bible says are sins are not thought of as sins in the eyes of the world. And people might think that we are backwards thinking, that we might be crazy for believing in the virgin birth and the resurrection, or they might say that science has disproved the possibility of miracles. Even today, it takes boldness and the Holy Spirit's encouragement to be a witness for the one true God when the world wants to worship lesser things, when the world wishes to persist in its futile ways. Though God does not cause the evil we encounter in our lives, the trials we face are consequences of living in a fallen world. And God is able to use these bad experiences to refine us and to conform us to the character of his Son. This is one of the great marvels of God, that he can use broken people and bad experiences and reverse them in some way so as to gain something good out of it all. If someone mocks our faith, we can forgive them. If someone opposes us because of our faith, we can pray for them. We can love and we can serve people in advance, expecting nothing in return. For is that not what Christ did for us? Christ suffered on our behalf in order to atone for our sin. We can emulate our Messiah by also enduring suffering for his name's sake. Have you ever had an experience where you were ridiculed because of your faith? How did you respond? And perseverance during trials also proves the genuineness of our faith. Gold was the most prized material, but in the end, it's mere dross compared to genuine faith. Genuine faith, Peter says, is more precious than gold. How convincing is our faith in the eyes of others if at the first moment of peril or pain, we throw up our hands and declare, there must be no God because I am facing trouble. This faith would be very shallow indeed, but we would be better to look at the Apostle Paul, who wrote of his sufferings in 2 Corinthians chapter 11. He was imprisoned, he was lashed, beaten, shipwrecked, without shelter or food, and constantly in danger. But how many Christians over the centuries have looked back at Paul and seen a rock of faith? Are not our brothers and sisters in Christ who are suffering persecution in many parts of the world also rocks of faith? The New Testament continually tells us that to live as a Christian will be challenging. Paul and Barnabas told believers that we must go through many hardships to enter the kingdom of God. And this is not to ignore the very real hardships that we face. We experience a career setback, a broken relationship, a fatal diagnosis, a dark night of the soul. In the midst of these griefs, we can call upon God, the God of hope and the God of comfort, to guide us and to be present with us in our trials. God did not abandon the believers that Peter was writing to, and he does not abandon us when we desperately need him. And we must also remember that in trying times, in our trials, we can look ahead to our living hope, being with the loving, triune God for eternity. That in and of itself can be a great comfort to us. If we do not receive an earthly deliverance from our trials, we still have the joyous hope of an eternal deliverance. Even the most intense agony in this life will be but a drop compared to the ocean of joy that we will experience eternally in the presence of God. One Bible teacher sums it up like this. He says, "Regardless of how dark the future may be, there is a glory awaiting in the things of the Lord." This is what the Bible says, and this is what the Christian thinks. In the mind and heart of the believer in Christ, there is a forward look that is also an upward look of joyous expectation. In The Imitation of Christ, the Catholic mystic Thomas Aquinas wrote that trials can bring us closer to God and in deeper reliance upon him. He writes, "It is good for us to have trials and troubles at times, for they often remind us that we are on probation and ought not to hope in any worldly thing. It is good for us to sometimes suffer a contradiction, to be misjudged by men, even though we do well and mean well. These things help to keep us humble and shield us from vainglory. When to all outward appearances men give us no credit, when they do not think well of us, then we are more inclined to seek God, who sees our hearts. Therefore, a man ought to root himself so firmly in God that he will not need the consolations of men." We may not desire the trials we face. Many will be challenging and painful, but trials teach us to rely on God, and they themselves are invitations to holiness. Do we respond to our trials in abject despair, or do we rejoice at the hope that we have in Jesus? Do we respond to rejection and persecution with revenge, or do we leave judgment to God the Father, who judges all people impartially according to their deeds? So first, we have been graciously born again by God through Christ into a living hope. Second, we will have had to endure various trials. Now we come to the third point, the call to live in holiness. Now many people regard Christianity as a restrictive system of rules. Is holiness about keeping a list of rules and regulations? In a certain sense, yes it is, but keeping rules and regulations does not save us. Only grace through faith in Christ does that. Rather, we follow biblical commandments because we are disciples of Jesus Christ, our personal Savior, who has taught us how to live and who has given us his word. I like how the commentator Thomas Schreiner puts it. He says, "God's commandments are always rooted in his grace." Another way of putting this is to say that the indicative, or what God has done for us in Christ, is always the basis of the imperative, how we should live our lives. To confuse the order here would be disastrous, and the result would be works righteousness, instead of seeing holiness as the result of God's grace and power, as a response to the love of God in Christ. Christianity does not begin with rules. It does not start with morality. The place it starts with is Jesus Christ and with what he has done for us. Everything flows from this. And isn't that how Peter structures this very letter? He begins with praise. He reminds Christians of what Jesus has accomplished for them, and then he exhorts them to holy living. Jesus is the perfect Lamb who was willingly slain for our sins, and who was destined to deliver us even before the cosmos was created. That is why we live lives of holiness, out of sheer gratitude and awe of how much we have already been loved by Jesus Christ. He has already secured our salvation, our inheritance. He agreed to die for us even before we were even created. We do our best to live holy lives with the continuing and constant help of the Holy Spirit as a response to the love of God in Christ. And by following Jesus and God's word, we demonstrate our set-apartness from the fallen world. So, practically speaking, how do we live a life of holiness? In verse 13, Peter tells us to prepare your minds for action. Our thinking, our imagination, have to be transformed by the light of Christ, and this often takes cultivation and time. First, we should have a regular, and hopefully vibrant, devotional life that includes scripture reading and prayer. The Bible is a massive collection of books that together show us God's involvement in history, that teaches us about Him, and that gives us guidance for how we ought to live. And prayer is crucial too. As we bring our confessions and our petitions before God and listen attentively for Him to speak to us, we ask Him to intercede on behalf of others, to withstand temptations and trials, to take away our evil desires, and to instead instill in our minds whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is just, whatever is pure, whatever is pleasing, whatever is commendable, whatever is excellent and worthy of praise. And Scripture itself can help us if we do not know what to pray. We can pray the words of Scripture back to God. Now, a sanctified mind goes hand in hand with a disciplined body. Our bodies are temples of the Holy Spirit, and we must ensure that we do not profane them by our actions. We must be vigilant both in how we think and how we act, for Satan is always trying to entice us away from God. Christians are to be obedient children, and we're not to be conformed to the desires that we had formerly in ignorance. Now, do our desires resemble the desires of the world? What do you think the world thinks the good life is? Is it about money, fame, popularity, pleasure, power? What do you think the desires of the kingdom of God look like? One of the most influential Protestant catechisms tells us that the chief end of human beings is to glorify God and enjoy Him forever. So not only do Christians believe in the good life, we believe it lasts forever, for eternity. We are to conduct ourselves in a way that conforms us to the character of Christ in all that we do. Because God is holy, we strive to be holy as well. You know the old saying, like father, like son? Well, we are to be like God the Father, like son or daughter. We often speak of family resemblance, a child having their mother's eyes. But do people see a family resemblance between us and God in how we act? Are we generous like He is? Are we merciful like He is? Are we trustworthy and dependable like He is? Are we patient like He is? Do we love like He does? We are not expected to be like God in His deity, but to strive for human righteousness as demonstrated by Jesus Christ, who is the fullest and final revelation of God's character. Now, verse 17 tells us we live in exile, or as foreigners, as temporary residents. What does it mean to live in exile? It means to be away from home, in unfamiliar and uncomfortable surroundings. This is not our final destination. Our true home is with Christ when He returns. But for now, we dwell, and we work, and we live in the good world that He has made that also groans in its fallenness. The way we act, living in imitation of Christ our Savior, and according to the Bible, sets us apart as exiles and foreigners, because we do not live according to the values of the world, but according to the kingdom of God. Let's pray. Living God, we thank You for Your word. We ask that You help us to rejoice in You as we await Your return. We ask that You be present and near us in times of trial. We ask that You be with our brothers and sisters in Christ who are being persecuted for Your name's sake. And we ask that You conform us daily to the character of Christ as we live as exiles. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.